That those first days in jail, after you were sentenced to life, how were they?
Well, I thought about the life that I was facing, that behind bars I may be there forever and a day. So when I went back to the county jail, I thought about it. I wrote the jailer a letter, told him, you know, I've been tried, convicted, and sentenced. Now I'm ready to go on to the penitentiary, begin serving my time. I said, because, you know, if not, you know, I feel like tearing this place apart. And, you know, I had already gotten in fights in jail, you know, from guys running them out, and I wasn't willing to listen to that because I didn't have to. You know, I packed my belongings, and the very next day I was taken to the Central Prison in Raleigh, North Carolina.
After serving some of the time, another prisoner came to prison called Bobby Poole.
Yes.
And you became suspicious.
Yes, I was walking in the prison down a tunnel. I was on my way to work out because that's what I did every day. I worked the punching bag, the body bag, you know, to relieve tension and frustration from me for having to take it out on other inmates. I recognized this guy being escorted. I looked over and I said, I've seen this guy before. And I walked up to him and I said, excuse me. I said, but where are you from? He said, I'm from Burlington, North Carolina. I said, I am myself. I said, you look like the drawing of a composite sketch of a crime that I'm in prison for. Did you commit this crime? And he said, no. And he walked away. So I immediately went to my locker. I had a composite sketch, you know, of the guy in my locker. So I pulled the file and I looked at it and I compared it to him. I said, that's him. And so he became friends with another inmate. You know, the other inmate was into martial art and stuff like that. And me and him fought. And I had to, you know, let him know who were the boss. You know, not that I had to prove a point, but he confronted me and disrespected me. And so I had to fight this guy. And I broke his jaw. He went to segregation. He come back out and apologized to me. And that's when he told me that this guy had told him that he committed the crime I was in for. So I sat up that night about 2 o'clock in the morning and I was writing my attorney, letting him know what was told to me.
But still this didn't change anything, did it?
It did not, no.
It was, the case was tried again, but it didn't help you.
No.
Nobody believed you.
They didn't.
And 7 years more had to pass.
Yes.
Before something really changed. And that was, as I understand, the O.J. Simpson case.
The O.J. trial was on, and they was talking about DNA. And it caught my attention, and I became interested. So I started listening to it on the television when I could. And once I felt I had enough information, you know, about DNA, I decided that I needed to take it a little further. And by doing so, I wrote to the courts of appeal to ask for DNA to be done in my situation.
I wonder, all these years, this was 11 years. He was in prison for 11 years. How was your life these years?
Well, I had graduated college and I had fallen in love. I'd gotten married. I had triplets in the spring of 1990. And being a mother was everything I'd wanted to do. And so, you know, I had... You don't move on when you're raped, but I had moved forward as best as I could, and so my life, you know, was very complete. I was happy.
Did you ever think about him?
Oh gosh, yeah, every day.
In what sense? What did you think?
I hated him. I prayed for him to die.
Well, I reached over and I grabbed her hand, and I told her that. I had forgiven her years ago because that was the thing to do. You know, I felt in my heart, I don't want to, you know, suffer for something.